So I just read on my stopwatch because I have to somehow explain to you my last 8 years of my life's work in 10 minutes, and that's a little bit stressful. But the first thing that I would need to explain is that I'm going to be using the word land base. It's the opposite of the word landscape. When you say landscape, what that means is that you're a viewer of something. You might be an active viewer, but it's kind of like when you're looking at a painting or at like a photograph. And when you're looking at it, you're not actually engaged with it. When I say land-based, what I mean is that I'm going into the world and I'm wildcrafting natural dyes, and I am engaged in where I'm collecting from. So I'm aware that the plants that I'm wildcrafting, those might be providing food for bees or other pollinators. I don't want to be collecting lichen in the winter because even in the smallest amount, that can be food for deer. So it's just acknowledging where I am. Okay, so natural dyeing. Show of hands, has anybody here ever dyed anything, naturally or non-naturally? And how many people here have naturally dyed something? Okay, so I promise it's harder than it looks because it's not just somebody standing around a cauldron throwing in bugs and plants and then hoping that color stays. What you actually have to do is create a chemical bond between the color and the fiber. So the way that, what you want to happen is that you want to have fast color, and it doesn't mean that it's very quick. What it means is that light and washing won't affect your color at all. So it's light fast and it's wash fast. And the way that you do that is that you have to prepare your fabrics by scouring them, which is just washing them. Because anytime that we get any sort of industrial woven fabrics, they have sizing in them and they have spinning oil. And also inherently cotton grows with wax on it, so you have to get that off to get the color to stick. And then you have to soak the fibers in something called a mordant. And mordant means to bite. So what you're doing is you're cooking your fibers in either a salt-based compound or a heavy metal, and you're getting that, and that will actually get the color to bite onto the fiber. Supposedly it's a French word, which is very good. So this is where in natural dye world, a lot of like the fears around like safety come from. Because we as natural dyers, and by we I mean the royal we, me and the other natural dyers, we traditionally use things like powdered aluminum, powdered chrome, and powdered tin, and all of these things, if you inhale them, they cause cancer or they cause any number of things that I don't really want, because I'm planning on living to like 98, so I'm doing my best. So, The color that gives you, or sorry, the mordant slash modifier that gives you the truest color that the plant wants to give you is alum. It's like a salt. It's the same thing that you use to make pickles, and that will just give you the truest color. So, when you dye a piece of wool with red clover and you prepared it with alum, it goes yellow, but then when you add the addition of iron, it goes green. This is kind of what I've been doing all summer, is cutting out all of these squares, preparing them all at the same time, mordanting them all with alum. So then I dye two at a time, and then the one I take out and I have that as my sample, and then the other one goes into a mordant or modifier, and then that shows the variants of colors that I can get. So this is fresh maple leaves, is a yellow, and then with the addition of iron is a dark green, which you guys can see my weird box of fabric after if you'd like. So that's where mordants and modifiers come in. They're very important. I think that probably the greatest thing that I think that I've done so far is that I've made a color wheel of 30 colors that were all wildcrafted or grown from within 5 kilometers of here. With 15 dye pots. So I feel like that's some sort of like magical witchcraft or science, which is very good. Something that I learned as a natural dyer is that with the addition of some things, like cream of tartar, which you can make meringue with, but also it softens the wool when you're working with it, I learned the hard way that it also makes logwood, which should be dyeing a beautiful purple color, it just grays out your colors. So when you put something into a dye pot, the surprise that came out for me was this like kind of like stormy gray color, which is endearing, but not at all what I was looking for. So I always knew that there was like this great science that came along with natural dyes, and I knew all the steps that had to come to get the color to stay and to be fast. But it was studying under a French chemist, his name is Michel Garcia. That's where I actually learned the science, because me and with my art brain, I never took chemistry in high school because I didn't think that I really needed it. And now past me kind of messed it up for future me, because now I'm trying to go back and get all this, these science things. Because this beautiful man, this tiny French chemist, who's like a natural dye wizard, he was the one that taught me about why some colors break. And when I say break, it's that colors like madder, which is like a red color that comes from a root, if you heat it up too hot, all of the little molecules that stick together in a line, they break and they become a dark brown color. And that to me is like one of the most interesting things, is to actually see it, because I'm a visual person. And for that, then I get to actually know why something is. Because when I started natural dyeing, I did it in textile school, and I kind of picked it up because I really liked the aesthetic of all of my teachers standing around a cauldron stirring a pot. And I was like, those are my people. So now I'm getting a little bit farther into that science. So, and so all of these metals that I was talking about, I don't use the powdered chrome and the powdered tin, but I do use iron. Because iron as a mordant, it's a saddener, that's what people say, because it makes all the colors, it takes them and it makes them dark. Those colors that I was showing you earlier, the yellows go into like these like gloomy gray colors, but those I actually make my own iron mordants at home just by putting rusty metal into vinegar and just letting it sludge around, and then it becomes this iron solution. So I use iron and at no more than 4% the weight of my fiber. So if I have 100 grams of fiber, I use no more than 4 grams of this iron. But traditionally, you'd be using it at 1 or 2 or 300% the weight of your fiber. So when you look back at tapestries or like weavings from 500, 600, or 700 years ago, because pre-industrial revolution, all colors that would have been on cloth would have been natural. They would use these mordants and modifiers at such great percentages that the fiber would become brittle. So you know when you go to like an art gallery and you see these big woven tapestries and there's just whole chunks missing? That's not because like when you view it, your eye kind of deletes it out of existence. But that would have either been the brightest or the darkest place in the tapestry, just because the nature of cloth is that it's ephemeral. It does go away, and when we use mordants and modifiers in such a great amount, they go. Yeah, so this is it. That's color for me. I hope you enjoy it. Thank you so much.